Good morning, I'm Stanley Palisada.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. The headlines: Chinese leader Xi Jinping and other foreign diplomats congratulate newly sworn-in Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
Former Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte returns to his Davao City hometown as a private citizen.
The Philippines logs over 1,000 new COVID-19 cases, the highest daily tally in over 4 months.
And the U.S. suffers a huge blow in its fight against climate change as the Supreme Court limits Washington's authority to reduce carbon output from power plants.
Welcome to the program. Chinese President Xi Jinping ready to work with the Philippines' new leader. In his congratulatory letter, Xi told Ferdinand Marcos Jr. that he is willing to work with him to continue writing a great chapter of China-Philippine relations. Chinese Vice President Wang Qishan, who represented Xi during Thursday's inauguration, also presented a four-point proposal to enhance bilateral ties. According to Chinese state media CCTV, Marcos told Wang that Beijing was Manila's most powerful partner and that his administration is willing to deepen the country's participation in China's Belt and Road Initiative. There was no mention of China's increased military activities in disputed waters, but Japanese Foreign Minister Yoshimasa Hayashi also met with Marcos, said the Philippine leader agreed to cooperate with Tokyo to maintain and reinforce rules-based maritime order. Hayashi added Japan will support the Philippines' effort to enhance equipment of its Coast Guard.
Other foreign diplomats personally congratulated President Marcos Jr. at a post-inaugural reception at the National Museum. The papal envoy spoke on their behalf as Dean of the Diplomatic Corps to pledge their cooperation with his administration.
The Filipino people have placed their trust and their hopes in you, their hopes for a future that is prosperous, safe, equitable, and just. We too, in the international community, harbor the same hopes for your presidency and for your nation, and that we pledge our cooperation and collaboration with your administration in achieving the success of your mandate.
Marcos expressed gratitude to foreign governments for seeking to boost ties with the Philippines under his leadership.
We can only go from here to strength and to strength and to strength. And for that, that is what I look forward to, that the day will come when we can say that we have built upon the strong foundation that we came upon.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s inaugural address was centered on a hope for a better future. He assured Filipinos his plan for the country's economic transformation will benefit all. Marcos also called on Filipinos not to look back, but to look ahead to the country's post-pandemic recovery.
The changes we seek will benefit all and will shortchange no one. I was not the instrument of change. You were that. You made it happen. I am here not to talk about the past. I am here to tell you about our future. A future of sufficiency, even plenty, of readily available ways and means to get done what needs doing by you, by me. We do not look back, but ahead. We are presently drawing up a comprehensive, all-inclusive plan for economic transformation. We will build back better by doing things in the light of the experiences that we have had, both good and bad. It doesn't matter. No looking back in anger or nostalgia. In the road ahead, the immediate months will be rough, but I will walk that road with you.
The new president also praised his father, the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos Sr. The younger Marcos claims the country prospered under his father's watch.
I once knew a man who saw what little had been achieved since independence in a land of people with the greatest potential for achievement. And yet, they were poor. But he got it done, sometimes with the needed support, sometimes without. So will it be with his son. You will get no excuses from me. The role of agriculture cries for the urgent attention that its neglect and misdirection now demands. Food self-sufficiency has been the key promise of every administration. None but one delivered. The sun also rises like it did today and as it will tomorrow. And as surely as that, we will achieve the country all Filipinos deserve. God bless the Philippines.
President Marcos also vowing to reform the Philippines' education system. He emphasized the need to change the way some subjects are being taught to make Filipino students more globally competitive. This includes science subjects and vocational studies, but not history.
What we teach in our schools, the materials used must be rethought. I am not talking about history. I am talking about the basics, the sciences, sharpening theoretical aptitude and imparting vocational skills, such as in the German example, alongside the national language with equal emphasis and facility in a global language, which we had and lost. Once we had an education system that prepared coming generations for more and better jobs, there is hope for a comeback. Vice President and soon-to-be Secretary of Education Sara Duterte Carpio will fit that mission to a T.
President Marcos also vowed to complete ongoing infrastructure projects during his term. This after former President Rodrigo Duterte appealed to his successor to continue the projects that had been started. Marcos also praised his father's and Duterte's infrastructure programs during his inaugural address.
My father built more and better roads, produced more rice than all administrations before his. President Rodrigo Roa Duterte built more and better than all the administrations succeeding my father's. Following these giant steps, we will continue to build. I will complete on schedule the projects that have been started. I'm not interested in taking credit. I want to build on success that's already happening. We will be presenting the public with a comprehensive infrastructure plan. 6 years could be just about enough time.
Marcos also said the Philippines can find a way around its energy supply problems. He also hinted at his preference for renewable energy, even claiming he built the windmills in Ilocos Norte.
We have yet to see large-scale practical solutions to pollution, though some are beginning to emerge. But there are tried and proven new ways of mitigation. Blades have been turning over the sand dunes of Ilocos Norte, harnessing a power all around, but unseen, long before this day. I built them.
In an interview with ANC in 2010, Marcos also acknowledged the wind farm was a private commercial enterprise. The Bangi windmills were developed and constructed by the Northwind Power Development Corporation.
Philippine President Marcos's inaugural address found wanting of key issues by an international human rights group. Carlos Conde of Human Rights Watch says Marcos's speech may have looked good on the surface, but he notes it failed to touch on the very issues that hounded the dictatorship of the Marcos's father.
This might be, you know, ironic to expect of a president like Mr. Marcos to for him to say some things about, you know, social justice, human rights, press freedom. But these are real issues in the Philippines. And these are issues, you know, the democratic ideals are real issues that we have been confronting since the ouster of his late father. And for him to leave out any mention of those, even just a short shrift, even just, you know, to acknowledge that these problems existed and persisted, would have made a little difference.
Joining us now is Attorney Ruben Carranza, the former commissioner of the Presidential Commission on Good Government, the agency tasked to go after the Marcos family's ill-gotten wealth. He is now a senior expert at the International Center for Transitional Justice. Good morning, Attorney Carranza, and welcome to the Rundown.
Good morning, Stanley.
All right. You must have heard the speech. What did you think of President Marcos's inaugural address first?
In terms of form.
Form and substance, perhaps, last? Right.
Yes. In terms of form, now we understand why he refused to debate.
All right.
There is simply no skill in terms of what he was saying, which often contradicted the paragraphs previous to what he said. So he would say, let's not look back, let's not be nostalgic, and then in the same breath talks about his father, and talks about his father as if the things he talked about were true. So on substance as well, it contained many of the lies and disinformation that characterized his campaign. And therefore, I guess that is what the Marcoses are all about, disinformation and ignoring the past.
Right. He often referred to the future throughout the entire duration of that 25-minute speech. What kind of future are you seeing, given what you've heard and what you know?
Well, the reason he said he won't talk about the past is obvious. He was, in effect, invoking his right against self-incrimination. There's a technical legal reason why any Marcos, including Ferdinand Marcos Jr., refuses to talk about the past, because not only is there a tax liability that technically can lead to criminal liability if he continues to avoid paying the estate tax due from his father's estate, but even the ill-gotten wealth case decided in 2003 could implicate him in the same way that his mother was implicated and convicted of corruption in 2018. Marcos Jr. could be implicated as an accessory after the fact. In Philippine law, that means benefiting from the crime, and in this case, benefiting from ill-gotten wealth. So any person who might be implicated will, of course, say in his inaugural speech that he won't talk about the past. He claims he will talk about the future, and yet the same speech completely omits any discussion about corruption, does not refer in any way to human rights, mostly praises his father, and then returns to the worn-out theme of unity in a country that, in fact, has been divided precisely because of what the Marcoses did.
All right. Now, when we start talking about ill-gotten wealth, the PCGG, the Presidential Commission on Good Government, comes to mind. And when you talk about not looking to the past and just looking at the future, that is contrary to the PCGG's existence and perhaps mandate. How are things now with the PCGG, given all of those?
Well, the fact is the PCGG has continued to exist under different presidents, including presidents who threatened to abolish the commission.
Right.
If they really wanted to abolish the commission, if they in fact thought that the commission was useless, they could have done it. Estrada could have done it. Arroyo could have done it. Duterte could have done it. And yet they appointed people to the commission, and those people did what the commission is supposed to do to some extent. Now, the Marcoses are afraid of abolishing the commission because then their intentions would become obvious. But there's another reason why the Marcoses might not, in fact, abolish the commission. They want to use it to go after their own cronies to get what they claim is 60% of what these cronies control in businesses and have them returned, not to the Filipino people. This is not about recovering ill-gotten wealth, but recovering money stolen by the Marcoses, held by Marcos cronies, and now the Marcoses want that money in their pockets.
All right, still about PCGG, how much of the supposed ill-gotten wealth of the Marcoses have been recovered, or perhaps in terms of percentages looking to the past 30 years? And what would you say are the landmark achievements of the PCGG?
Well, this is all based on fact, and the Office of the President, which the PCGG is under, in fact, has disclosed this information. If the estimate is between $5 to $10 billion was stolen by the Marcoses and their cronies during the dictatorship, about $3 billion of that has been recovered. So the range of assets that have not been recovered up to now can be from $2 billion, a low of $2 billion, to a high of $7 billion. The recovered $3 billion includes $680 million in Swiss bank accounts that was recovered when I was in the PCGG, and our chairperson was Heidi Yorak, and that's the same money that in fact funded reparations for 11,000 victims of the Marcos dictatorship. So there's a law giving reparations to victims of the Marcos dictatorship. There's a 2003 Supreme Court decision saying that the Marcos spouses stole money from the Republic of the Philippines. And Ferdinand Marcos Jr. just took an oath yesterday under our constitution that in fact explicitly talks about the ill-gotten wealth of the Marcoses having no deadline in terms of their recovery.
All right, you mentioned some figures. That's $3 billion, about $2 billion still unrecovered. Perhaps the number would be ranging from $5 to $7 billion. So that's about 30 to 50% recovered. Was that the kind of success rate that you've expected or you would have wanted for the PCGG?
The PCGG was the first of its kind, the first agency of its kind in the world. Mm-hmm. The only other attempt in the past to recover assets from, to freeze assets in Switzerland, for example, was an attempt to freeze the assets of Nazi Germany, Hitler, mm-hmm. During World War II, but even that failed. So the Marcoses were the very first family whose assets was frozen by Switzerland. So many of the successes, as well as the failures mm-hmm. of the PCGG, are successes and failures that in part were brought about by the testing and the piloting of steps that could have been done better. On, you know, hindsight is 2020. When I came into the PCGG, there was already 15 years of litigation that I could not do anything about. So I had to deal with that. And we did succeed. We recovered 170 billion pesos in coconut levy funds that were stolen by the Marcoses and their cronies. Mm-hmm. We recovered $680 million from Swiss bank accounts. And in many ways, we restored, at least at that point, some respect for the PCGG under Heidi Yorak.
All right, so you're saying the PCGG was, of course, work in progress in its inception in the 80s or after the EDSA revolution and going through about three decades, several presidents. Through all of those decades, the commission was also marred by scandals, perhaps corruption allegations. It was not a perfect organization. Now, how did this contribute to its overall performance in terms of running after the ill-gotten wealth and other objectives?
Well, that obviously affected the integrity of the commission. But more than the integrity of the commission, I think, was the fact that many of those who were in the commission, with some very good exceptions, however, were in fact not very conscious of exactly what the function was of the PCGG. Mm-hmm. And it required people with an understanding of the history of the Marcos dictatorship and some skill involving forensic accounting, involving litigation on banking laws, involving international human rights, to accomplish some of what was accomplished by the PCGG. Now, having said all that, the PCGG is a presidential commission. It's not just a commission. A lot of what happened under what the PCGG did or did not do depended as well on the president to whom it was reporting.
All right. Let's take a look now at post-1986 EDSA revolution. That was a time when the Marcoses were not as powerful. Yet, why was it still difficult to recover the supposed ill-gotten wealth? And what were the common stumbling blocks, perhaps, if you will, in terms of recovering and dispensation even of appropriate cases and charges against the Marcoses?
Well, one important factor is this. The PCGG is not in charge of litigating criminal criminal cases against the Marcoses and their cronies.
Okay.
That is a function of the special prosecutor under the ombudsman. And there was a point in that period you referred to, Stanley, in which the ombudsman was someone who, in my opinion, was willing to give up cases filed by the PCGG. And that led to several cases that were delayed. We had to appeal to the Supreme Court. One of the most significant is the Bataan nuclear power plant case, where the cousin of Ferdinand Marcos Jr., the uncle of Ferdinand Marcos Sr., the cousin of his mother, obtained through bribery about 50 billion pesos, and now has been asked to pay a billion from that. It took a decade, and then he died, but now that amount is still owed by the family of Herminio Dicini and Ferdinand Marcos. Before he even talks about energy self-sufficiency and building a nuclear plant, should perhaps collect that money from his own family member.
All right, let's fast forward to recent days. Very recently, the Sandigan Bayan said it will allow now the Marcos heirs to present evidence concerning ill-gotten wealth. Possibly next week, July 7, that's of course to ferret out the truth. Are you hopeful that this accommodation will result in at least some clarity in the events in the last 30 or three decades that have not been cleared up? I mean, what are you expecting the Marcoses to present on that day?
I checked that decision that you referred to, Stanley, and it's really just a decision in one case involving Marcos cronies connected with the old Silahis Hotel. That family, close to the Marcoses, Marcos cronies, were recipients of behest loans during the dictatorship. Mm-hmm. And the Marcoses are implicated because that's how all these cases have to include the Marcoses as co-defendants. So this isn't a case that is of any importance more than the 2003 decision of the Supreme Court that clearly said that the Marcos spouses stole money from the Republic of the Philippines. The Marcoses have always been allowed to present evidence. What they do instead is to delay the litigation so that they get political accommodation in the future, and that's what they got today.
Yeah, but the difference is they are in power now, and that could be good for public relations in terms of shaping public opinion about ill-gotten wealth in general.
Well, if they really wanted to help the public, the Filipino people, including people who want ill-gotten assets recovered, there's something that is much easier, less complicated, less time-consuming that the Marcoses can do. They can surrender the assets that they have been hiding up to now. Marcos Jr. can admit that his father and his mother stole money from the Republic of the Philippines and promised to return that money and to ensure that it will never happen again. He can do that. He hasn't done that. He wants to look to the future. He wants to avoid talking about the past because he's afraid of incriminating himself.
And now we look to the future in the next 6 years. How much more do you think the PCGG can accomplish?
The PCGG is, like I said, a presidential commission. If any agency of the Republic of the Philippines headed by a president who refuses to acknowledge the human rights violations committed by his family, who refuses to acknowledge the corruption committed by his parents, who refuses to accept that he himself has had a role in ensuring the family's impunity from corruption, can only do so much. Now, we're talking here about the very agency that is meant to go after the Marcos family, the family of the president. I don't think we can expect much.
All right, let's leave it at that. Attorney Ruben Carranza, thank you so much for joining us today. Good morning.
Thank you for having me. Good morning.
Moving on, the country's new leader carried out his first official act, swearing in his cabinet members hours after his inauguration. He also led the oath-taking of newly elected officials from his home province, Ilocos Norte. Among them, his own son, Ilocos Norte Representative Sandro Marcos.
This was my doing because I insisted that this is a very important chance for me. When else will I be able to swear in as president our mayors, our congressmen, and our officials from Ilocos Norte?
A Thanksgiving concert for President Marcos was held on Thursday afternoon at the Menjola Peace Arch near Malacañang. Music veteran Randy Santiago and comedian Bayani Agbayani and rapper Andrew E were among the performers. The hosts initially said Marcos would be appearing at the event, but he ended up skipping it. Around 2,000 people attended the concert.
Hintay po talaga namin. Tsaka kasi siyempre siya po yung binoto namin.
Anong nararamdaman dito ba 'te?
Ela, medyo malungkot pero okay lang, nabasa kami, enjoy naman kami.
Masaya pa rin. Mulat umarang.
Oh.
Rain or shine, andito kami pa rin.
Now, protests also greeted the inauguration of President Marcos. Before Marcos took his oath, the whole Plaza Miranda in Manila was teeming with members of various sectors from human rights, transportation, the youth, and public health.
Ang Plaza Miranda kasi historic ito pagdating sa paglaban sa diktadurang Marcos. Kaya nga maganda rin mairaos dito bilang bahagi ng ating pag-alala doon sa nakaraan ng diktadura.
Ang hamon sa atin sa pag-uupong presidente ay dapat bigyang prioridad ang kapakanan at kagalingan nating mga manggagawang pagkalusugan sa usapin na nakabubuhay na sahod, security of tenure, pagdagdag ng mga regular plantilla positions para sa lahat ng nagagawang pagkalusugan.
Meanwhile, Marcos supporters say they are not affected by what critics say against the new president.
Since day one na pagkampanya po, lagi po akong nakaano sa kanya, nakasubaybay po ako sa kanya. Mas gusto ko po siya ang manalong bilang presidente po talaga.
Rodrigo Duterte back in Davao City after turning over the Philippine presidency to Bongbong Marcos. Duterte's commercial flight arrived at the Davao City International Airport on Thursday evening, where a water salute was done as a tribute to the former chief executive. A homecoming concert was also held for him. But before his exit from Malacañang, he made an appeal to Filipinos to support his successor. Pia Gutierrez has the support.
36 years after his family was ousted from Malacañang, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. finally returns to the palace, this time as the 17th president of the Philippines. Following the tradition of those who came before him, Marcos Jr. first went to Malacañang Thursday morning to meet with his predecessor, Rodrigo Duterte, a symbol of a peaceful transition of power between the incoming and outgoing leaders. Marcos Jr. arrived at the palace a few minutes before 10:30 in the morning, where he was greeted by Duterte on top of the palace staircase. From here, Marcos Jr. signed the palace guestbook, his name and signature being the last entry for the Duterte administration. The mood between the two leaders was cordial and cheerful, despite Duterte calling his successor a spoiled brat and weak leader months earlier. The meeting, however, lasted less than 10 minutes, after which they both descended the grand staircase and into the Kalayaan grounds, where Duterte was given his last honors as President of the Philippines. Had the tradition been followed, the outgoing president would have accompanied his successor all the way to the inaugural venue, where he would be given his last honors, signaling the end of his term and a return to his life as an ordinary citizen. Duterte, however, did not follow this tradition, choosing instead to leave from Malacañang after a quick goodbye to the members of his cabinet. Marcos Jr. then proceeded to the National Museum without his predecessor. In an earlier video, however, Duterte expressed his support for the new administration as he urged the public to help Marcos Jr.
Let us give all our support to the new administration. Tulungan natin. Tulungan natin.
Meanwhile, prior to his return to Davao City on board a commercial flight, the former president spent his first hours as citizen digong by going to a mall in Makati. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Now, former Budget Secretary Rolando Andaya Jr. passed away Thursday. He was 53. Andaya's children announced his death on social media but did not specify the cause. Andaya once served as Camarines Sur representative. He lost his bid to become Camarines Sur governor in the May elections. Andaya previously made headlines when he suggested that then Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte could run for president with former Defense Chief Gilbert Chudoro as her running mate. He later backed the presidential bid of former Vice President Lenny Robredo. We're taking a quick break up ahead. The Philippines logs over 1,000 new COVID-19 cases, the highest daily tally in over 4 months.
And the U.S. suffers a huge blow in its fight against climate change as the Supreme Court limits Washington's authority to reduce carbon output from power plants. These and more when the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the Rundown. The Philippines recorded 1,309 new COVID-19 cases on Thursday. That's the highest single daily tally in over 4 months, or since February 25, and pushes the number of active cases to nearly 8,000. Metro Manila accounted for almost half of the new infections. The health department also reported 13 additional COVID deaths.
COVID-19 cases in Europe also on the rise. The World Health Organization warns the region could see high levels of infections this summer. That's from June to September this year. The UN agency cites the lifting of COVID-19 restrictions for the expected increase. Based on its data, COVID cases have already tripled in the past month, with the region currently registering under 500,000 cases daily, up from just around 150,000 at the end of May.
The Philippines joins 25 other countries in the biennial RM of the Rim of the Pacific drills. Now it's deemed as the world's largest international maritime exercise. The BRP Antonio Luna, a guided missile frigate, will be participating on behalf of the Philippine Navy. The U.S. Navy says the drills will give participating countries the opportunity to refine individual and combined maritime abilities and help promote a free and open Indo-Pacific. The wartime drills will be conducted in and around the Hawaiian Islands and Southern California until August 4th. It comes amid China's rising influence and aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
The U.S. Supreme Court deals a blow to the Biden administration's battle against climate change. The High Court on Thursday ruled the government's key environmental agency does not have the power to set sweeping caps on greenhouse gases from coal-fired power plants. President Joe Biden had been hoping to use the Environmental Protection Agency to bring down emissions to meet global climate goals that were set in the 2015 Paris Agreement. Biden called the ruling devastating, but he vowed to take action and find ways to continue protecting Americans. The United Nations, meanwhile, called it a setback in the fight against climate change.
Decisions like today's in the U.S. or any other major emitting economy makes it harder to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement for a healthy, livable planet. This is a setback in our fight against climate change when we are already far off track in meeting the goals of the Paris Agreement. The Secretary General has said repeatedly that the G20 must lead the way in dramatically stepping up climate action.
Chinese President Xi Jinping makes his first visit to Hong Kong in about 3 years. Xi arrived in the Special Administrative Region on Thursday, where he met with Hong Kong Chief Executive Carrie Lam and other officials ahead of the 25th anniversary of the city's return to Chinese rule. He is expected to lead the celebrations today, Friday, and inaugurate Hong Kong's new government. The move is seen to showcase the Chinese Communist Party's power over the business hub 3 years after it unleashed a harsh crackdown on pro-democracy protesters. Xi claims Hong Kong has been reborn, and with one country, two systems policy firmly in place, its future will be better.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing today with our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Good morning, guys. Here are the latest stories making headlines in the Filipino community.
We begin in New York City, where a die-in protest was held in the middle of a crowded Times Square. And songs were sung to represent these Philam activists' sentiments against the newly sworn-in Philippine President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr.
We we reject the Marcos and Duterte tandem. We will continue to fight historical revisionism, and we will continue to fight for the Filipino people back home and abroad.
Ria Ortiz, a daughter of a martial law survivor, says there's re-traumatization happening for all the victims.
You're just seeing the son of the late dictator. It's so unthinkable that this is happening right now.
Meanwhile, a similar protest was held in Los Angeles, where PhilHam activists continued to question election results.
We know that the election was based off of a lot of disinformation and vote buying and cheating.
They add that even before Marcos was sworn in, they were already concerned over the Philippine Securities and Exchange Commission's ruling to shut down news media site Rappler.
I am here not to talk about the past. I am here to tell you about our future. A future of sufficiency, even plenty of readily available ways and means to get done what needs doing.
As for the president's supporters in Southern California, a number of them actually went to the Philippines for the inauguration. They'll be holding a local event with the president's nephew, Ilocos Norte Governor Matthew Manotok, next month, an event that some protesters already plan on crashing.
First runner-up is Elizabeth Medina.
And in other news, it was an eight-year journey for a PhilHam beauty queen, and now the Miss USA crown is closer than ever for Suzanne Perez. The 25-year-old, who is pursuing her master's at Eastern New Mexico University, took home the Miss New Mexico USA crown and became the first Filipina to win the title.
Miss USA, Miss Universe has always been my number one dream, my number one goal. I remember watching Miss USA back in 2016 and just looking at those girls like they were the most amazing, empowering women that I've ever seen. And I never even thought that I would become one of those girls. But I knew that God planted the dream in my heart for a reason. I needed to keep going.
The Southern California native with roots in Surigao del Sur, Philippines, had previously spearheaded humanitarian efforts for victims of the Taal volcanic eruption.
The charity work that I did through pageantry really just became my life.
And those were the latest from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. And on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to you guys for the rundown.
A veteran journalist urges Philippine news media to be more aggressive in their coverage of the new Marcos administration. The call made by Melinda Quintos de Jesus of the Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility. De Jesus says Filipino news journalists must double their efforts to counter any attempt by the government to silence dissent.
I think there's a challenge, and the challenge is bigger than what we may be ready to actually address. The landscape has changed immensely, and if the government adds to it the weight of its force in terms of trying to silence criticism and dissenting voices, then we are definitely going to be called on to do something much more than what we have been doing so far. We need to get out where they are. Where is it? We need to get the news out there in all the different digital platforms that they, where the people are already. We will have to reinvent the ways in which to make news more brief, more direct, more speaking their own vernacular language, the different styles in which they take on, the visualization of data.
Justice Alexander G. Gasmundo.
De Jesus believes Marcos Jr. does not deserve the traditional honeymoon given by the news media to newly elected presidents.
Each new president is given a 100-day or maybe less honeymoon period by the press. Thus, President Bongbong Marcos deserved a honeymoon from us.
No, because the family has had such a long relationship with us, in or out of bedroom, in or out of office, that that thing has been going on, and we've already forgotten so many parts of it. So a honeymoon where you pretend that everything is going well is no longer affordable. We really should not have provided that also with Mr. Duterte.
The Marcos inauguration, described by major international news agencies as a stunning political comeback for one of the most famous political dynasties in the Philippines and Asia. Al Jazeera observes Thursday's inaugural event was far grander than that of past Philippine presidents. The BBC points out it marks the culmination of a decades-long struggle by the Marcoses to reclaim their political glory. CNN highlighted how Marcos Jr. praised his late father in his inaugural address. The cable news network also noted how the inauguration restored one of the Philippines' most notorious political dynasties to political dominance. Channel News Asia describes Marcos Jr.'s inaugural address as a stirring speech that echoed his campaign slogans of unity.
We're taking another breather still to come. OPEC and its allies stick to a planned output increase in August.
And the Philippine Central Bank sees inflation accelerating further in June. These and more when the rundown returns.
You're back on the rundown. OPEC and its allies stick to a planned output increase in August, defying calls to pump more barrels to cool crude prices. The group will increase monthly overall production for August to 648,000 barrels per day. OPEC Plus has been slowly returning to nearly 10 million barrels per day. It pulled from the market in April 2020 when the pandemic hit demand. Oil prices slipped on Thursday after OPEC's decision and amid concerns about global supply tightness. International benchmark Brent crude fell to $114 a barrel, while U.S. crude settled at $108.
The Philippine Central Bank sees inflation accelerating further in June. The BSP expects the consumer price index to settle within the range of 5.7 to 6.5%. That's way above government's target range of 2 to 4% and even higher than the 5.4% inflation recorded in May. The BSP cites the continued increase in oil and power prices and the peso's depreciation as primary sources of inflationary pressures for the month. The central bank has raised its benchmark interest rate twice this year to 2.5% in a bid to tame inflation.
Public utility vehicle drivers not satisfied with the latest 2 peso fare hike granted by transport regulators. This report from Lady Vicencio.
The 2 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys will be implemented across the country on July 1st. Base fare will be at 11 pesos in Metro Manila, Region 3 and 4. For modern jeepneys, minimum fare nationwide will be at 13 pesos. But for many jeepney drivers, the fare increase is hardly enough. Public utility drivers argue a meager fare adjustment will not offset the soaring cost of fuel and basic needs.
Yung diesel natin, ma'am, nasa mga 90 plus na, ma'am, eh. Tapos, ma'am, yung pasahero, madalang. Parang wala din nangyari.
Ang provisional increase po na hinihingi nila based on the omnibus motion that they filed last June 23 was a 2 pesos na provisional increase. So,
okay.
Kumbaga, noong June 8, they were already given 1 peso. So, ang dinagdag natin ngayon, 1 peso na lang for NCR, Region 3, and Region 4.
Transport group Piston believes a number of jeepney drivers who changed livelihood because of rising oil prices might return behind the wheel. A commuters group agrees with the fare hike, but more needs to be done to help the transport sector.
Sa amin po ay maluwag namin tinatanggap yan. Pero dahil po naiintindihan din po namin ang tunay na kalagayan ng drivers, ang inaasahan po namin din ay maging 12 pesos. Dahil nga yung computation yan, lumalabas po na ang kanilang ang idinagdag lang natin sa pang-araw-araw na kanilang kita ay 5 liters. Kulang pa rin yung idinagdag natin.
But not all passengers welcome the fare adjustment, saying any increase is an expense they can do without.
Malaking bagay na po. Parehas ko po, tatlong sakay.
Pag kinumpit po yun sa loob ng isang buwan, malaking bagay rin po sa budget po sana namin. Halimbawa sa amin po ng mga nagtatrabaho, malaking bagay rin pong pandagdag sa pangkain namin po yun.
Transport regulators have yet to decide on fare hike petitions for taxis, TNVS, and buses, which will now be decided on by the Marcos administration. Lady Vicentio, ABS-CBN News.
A look now at the financial markets. Wall Street ended lower on Thursday, crossing the finish line of a grim month and quarter. The S&P 500 fell 0.8%, capping its worst first-half slide since 1970, down 21% since the start of the year. Meanwhile, the tech-heavy Nasdaq dropped 1.3% and is down 22% for the second quarter. The Dow lost 253 points. Over in Europe, markets also slumped on the final trading day of the first half as global market sentiment remains gloomy. And here in Asia, markets were mixed, with mainland Chinese stocks rising. This data showed factory activity in the country grew in June. The BSE index underperformed, falling 2.3% to 61.55 after Finance Secretary Benjamin Zhao warned inflation likely quickened further in June.
And before we go, Natalie Portman celebrates female strength as she stars in Thor: Love and Thunder. Young Chavez tells us more about some of the characters in the latest Marvel film to hit the big screen.
As an actress, Oscar winner Natalie Portman relishes the chance to transform and play various characters. For Thor: Love and Thunder, her physical preparations began months before the cameras rolled so she could return to the Marvel film franchise as Jane Foster, now also known as the Mighty Thor.
It's so exciting to get to play a character like Jane. I feel so lucky to get to be, get to be a superhero. That's like such an extraordinary opportunity, and I feel so lucky to have had the chance. And Jane is also such an incredible character as an astrophysicist. I feel like that's exciting to get to represent to girls.
Her co-star Tessa Thompson celebrated Portman's and the Thor's cast's return on the big screen. Thompson also shared what it meant for her to be part of a big Hollywood film.
Natalie rejoining us. She's a good friend of mine, so having her felt like summer camp. The last time around, they were a little more freewheeling. This time, they're like, Thor is having a midlife crisis. Valkyrie has finally turned herself around and is a woman of bureaucracy and responsibility. And so it's fun to play these characters that we love so much and see them grow as we grow too. I grew up in Los Angeles. I used to come to movies here. My dad would take me to this cinema, and it was always like a big deal when I got to see movies here. So I can't believe I am now in movies here.
The film recently held its star-studded world premiere in Hollywood, led by Thor himself, Chris Hemsworth. The latest Marvel movie also stars film actor Dave Bautista, who appears as his Guardians of the Galaxy character, Drax.
Thor: Love and Thunder is directed by Taika Waititi, who also returns in the movie as Korg. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Stanley Palisada. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery.